Christ lives, something every Christian now takes for granted. But it wasn't that way in the last few months of his ministry. In Luke, it says, "Then he took unto him the 12 and said unto them, Behold, we go up to Jerusalem, and all things that are written by the prophets concerning the Son of Man shall be accomplished. For he shall be delivered unto the Gentiles, and shall be mocked, and spitefully entreated, and spitted on, and they shall scourge him, and put him to death. And the third day he shall rise again." His disciples didn't realize how much Jesus would have to suffer. Scourging was a hideous torture. Lead balls or sharply pointed bones were attached to thin elm rods, which were used in a whipping fashion. The flesh of anyone receiving such punishment was ripped and torn with every stroke. After the scourging, Jesus was paraded before the scribes and the chief priests. And when Pilate asked them what was to be done with him, they cried out again and again, "Crucify him! Crucify him!" Jesus was made to carry the cross that he was to be crucified on to a place called Golgotha in Hebrew, Calvary in Latin. It means the place of a skull. Jesus was crucified with two criminals, a crowd gathered to watch. The crucifixion started about 9 in the morning. From noon until 3 p.m., a darkness fell over the land. Jesus suffered on the cross for 6 hours before he was heard to say, my God, why have you forsaken me?" Shortly thereafter, with a loud cry, he gave up his spirit. At that same time, there was a great earthquake, and the curtain in the temple was torn top to bottom, just as Jesus had told his disciples it would be. "I tell you the truth, not one stone here will be left on another. Every one will be thrown down." Many were the prophecies fulfilled on that day. In Matthew, it says, "A centurion on guard at the site knelt down and declared, Truly, this was the Son of God." I wonder, how many in that crowd must have looked at the centurions and asked themselves, "What have they done? What have they done?" Surrounds me. Give us Barabbas. Crucify this man. They beat and they curse me. Place a crown of thorns upon me. It's foretold in the scriptures, but they don't understand. Father, forgive them. The strength to see this through. Father, look at your son. What have they done? I hang on this cross. Two thieves here beside me. I watch the soldiers casting lots for my robe. They laugh and they mock me. Your father, he's forgot thee. Where are his angels now? Can't he spare even one? Father, forgive them. Have mercy on them. They know not what they do. Please don't forsake me. this cup from me, but grant me the strength to see this through. Father, look at your son. What have they done? Behold your son. And all at once the sky began to darken, and a cold wind blew hard out of the east. Thunder roared across the land, and the earth shook as a reed in the wind. The soldiers cowered and fell to the ground, for they feared the things that were happening around them. A lone voice cried out from among them, saying, God, hide us from your wrath, for this truly was the Christ, your Son. What have we done? What have we done? The centurion realized that Jesus was the Son of God. What he didn't realize was that he was just fulfilling another prophecy in the Scriptures. Matthew says, and they crucified him and parted his garments, casting lots that it might be fulfilled which was spoken by the prophet. They parted my garments among them, and among my vesture did they cast lots. And so his work was finished. Jesus had delivered his message, taught his disciples, and died on a cross for the sins of the world, that all who would believe in him would be saved. It was done, but it was far from over, for it was written, on the third day, he would rise again. On the morning of the third day, Mary Magdalene and Mary, the mother of James, came to the tomb carrying spices to anoint his body. They asked each other, who will roll the stone away? For a huge stone had been used to seal the tomb. When they arrived, they found it had been moved. Upon entering, they saw a young man dressed in a white robe, and he said, don't be alarmed. You are looking for Jesus, the Nazarene, who was crucified. He is risen. Jesus first appeared to Mary Magdalene. She went and told those who had been with him and who were mourning and weeping. But when they had heard that Jesus was alive, they did not believe it. Later, Jesus appeared to the 11 as they were eating. After having rebuked them for their lack of faith, he said to them, go into all the world and preach the gospel to all creation. Whoever believes and is baptized will be saved, but whoever does not believe will be condemned. After the Lord Jesus had spoken to them, he was taken up into heaven, and he sat at the right hand of God. All these things happened almost 2 millennia ago. But what about today? Open your eyes. The signs are all around us. The Gospel of Mark says, and then shall appear the sign of the Son of Man in heaven. And then shall all the tribes of the earth mourn, and they shall see the Son of Man coming in the clouds of heaven with power and great glory. And he shall send his angels with a great sound of a trumpet, and they shall gather together his elect from the four winds, from one end of heaven to the other. At that time, the door to redemption will be closed. Isaiah says, behold, the day of the Lord cometh, cruel both with wrath and fierce anger, to lay the land desolate, and he shall destroy the sinners thereof out of it. How many will be saved when Christ returns? What's more important are the words of Matthew? Ask not how many shall be saved, but will I be one of them?
What will you do on that morning when you awaken? What will you do on that morning when you awaken? I'll wash my face and ice cold water, made my breakfast like I ought to. But will you read the morning headlines and find the sky has gone away? What will you do when you find the sun isn't shining now? What will you do when you find that the sun isn't shining? I'll pray that I might be forgiven. These sins I've so well hidden, and will you pray that you'll be taken? To join the trumpet sound, seals are broken, the dead in Christ shall be awoken. The final battle
So ends my feeble attempt to condense the life of Jesus into a few minutes of song and dialogue. When I think of the millions of words that have been written about him, I'm humbled to have been able to add a few of my own. I often wonder what it would have been like to have walked beside him, to have witnessed firsthand the miracles he performed, to have heard him speak, to have seen the multitudes gather around him. I can only imagine. Like most of us, I doubt I'll ever be able to go to the Holy Lands and see the places where Jesus lived and taught. But sometimes, on a clear night, I go outside and I look up at the sky. If I see the moon, I think, this is the same moon that Jesus gazed on. It must have been a marvelous sight seen against the pitch-black skies of those times. Just knowing that I'm looking at something he too looked at leaves me with a feeling of awe and wonder. It's not a trip to the Holy Lands, but it still forms a bond that transcends the centuries. Who was Jesus? A prophet? The Messiah? A Savior? Surely he was all of these, and more. What manner of man could have had such an effect on those around him that the number of his followers would grow from 2, Peter and Andrew, to 2 billion? The fact is, no one, no king, dictator, or president, no parliament, government, or republic, no army or navy, no one in the history of the world has affected the lives of so many people as this one solitary man. The centurion was right. He truly is the Son of God. Blessed be Jesus. Amen.